Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel all about electronics. So in this video, we will learn about the master slave flip-flop. Now in the earlier video, we have already learned about the JK flip-flop. And we have also discussed the race around condition for this JK flip-flop. So we have seen that if the JK flip-flop is the level triggered, and if the on time of the clock is much more than the propagation delay of this flip-flop, then due to the feedback from the output to the input side, the output of the flip-flop will toggle continuously. And this is how the output of the flip-flop will look like. So of course, using the pulse transition circuit, we can generate the narrow pulses at the every clock transition. And in this way, we can use this gated latch as the ace-triggered flip-flop. But in that case also, we need to ensure that the pulse duration of this narrow pulse is greater than the propagation delay of these logic gates. Because if that is not satisfied, then we will not get the proper output. On the other end, if this pulse duration is much larger than the propagation delay of this flip-flop, then once again, we may encounter the race around condition in this JK flip-flop. That means the duration of this narrow pulse needs to be optimum. Of course, in the other flip-flops, we may not encounter such issue. But in case of the JK flip-flop, because of the feedback from the output to the input side, we may encounter the issue of the race around condition. So this issue can be resolved with the help of the master slave flip-flop. So first of all, let us see the design and the working of the master slave JK flip-flop. So as you can see, the circuit consists of a two NAND gate based SR latches. So here, the one latch acts as a master latch, while the second latch acts as a slave latch. And once we discuss the working of the circuit, then it will get clear to you why these latches are called master latch and the slave latch. So here, this J input is applied in place of the S input, while the K input is applied in place of the R input. And as you can see, the output of this master latch is connected to the slave latch. So here, to use this latch as the JK flip-flop, the Q bar output of the second latch is connected to the NAND gate where the J input is applied. And similarly, this Q output is connected to the NAND gate where this K input is applied. Apart from that, here the clock signal is directly applied to the master latch, while in case of the slave latch, the same clock signal is applied through the NOT gate. That means the slave latch receives the inverted clock signal. So as you can see, here this NAND gate is used as the inverter. And with the help of it, this inverted clock signal is generated. So that is the circuit of the master slave JK flip-flop. So now, let us see the working of this JK flip-flop. So using the couple of input sequences, let us understand how this master latch acts as a JK latch and how this slave latch follows the output of the master latch. And we will also see the same thing using the timing diagram. That means how the master responds to the input sequences and how the slave is following the master output. And we will also see that when both J and K inputs are 1, then how this flip-flop avoids the race around condition. So here, during the on time of the clock, this master latch will respond. And it will generate the output based on this J and K input, as well as the previous output Q and Q bar. Now since the second latch receives the inverted clock, so during the on time of the clock, the second latch will remain inactive. That means here, these two outputs will be equal to 1, and that is why it will hold its current state. So let's say initially, this Q output of the latch is equal to 0, and of course, this Q bar output is equal to 1. And initially, let's say, this J input is equal to 0, while this K input is equal to 1. So due to the feedback, this Q output will also appear over here, while this Q bar output will appear over here. So as you can see, for these both NAND gates, one of the input is equal to 0. And therefore, its both outputs will become 1. So initially, let's say this M output is also equal to 0. So the same 0 will appear over here, and due to that, this M bar output will remain 1. And the same 1 will also appear over here. That means the output of this first NAND gate will also remain 0. That means during the on time of this clock signal, with these inputs, the M output will become 0, while this M bar output will become 1. And that is also the expected result, right? Because for the JK flip-flop, we know that when this J is 0 and K is 1, then its output should become 0. So let us see the same thing in the timing diagram. So as you can see, initially, this J input is 0 and the K input is equal to 1. So during the on time of the clock, this M output will remain 0. Now once the clock signal becomes low, then the latch will become inactive. And because of that, it will maintain its present state. That means during the off time of the clock also, this M output will hold its present state. Now during the on time of the clock, since the slave latch is disabled, so it will maintain its present state. That means during this on time of this clock, this Q output will remain in the low condition. Now once the clock becomes low, then the slave latch will become active. And now it will respond to the inputs M and M bar. So during the off time of this clock, let us see how this slave latch will behave. So once this clock becomes inactive, then this output will become 1. And therefore, now this slave latch will become active. So in this case, if we see, then this M output is equal to 0, while this M bar output is equal to 1. So in this case, for this first NAND gate, since any one of the input is 0, so its output will become 1. On the other end, for the second NAND gate, since both inputs are 1, so its output will become 0. That means now, one of the input to this lower NAND gate is equal to 0. And therefore, its output will become 1. And the same 1 will also appear over here. That means for this fourth NAND gate, if we see, then its both inputs is equal to 1. And therefore, its output will become 0. That means whenever this master output is equal to 0 and 1, then for the slave latch, this S input is equal to 0, while this R input is equal to 1. And therefore, this latch should get reset. That means its Q output will become 0 and the Q bar output will become 1. So if you see the same thing in the timing diagram, then during this off time of the clock, this Q output will remain 0. Now once again, during the next clock cycle, this slave latch will become inactive and therefore it will maintain its present state. That means during this on time of the clock also, this Q output will remain 0. But during that time, let us see the output of this master latch. So once again, during the next clock cycle, this J input is 1, while this K input is equal to 0. That means here, this J is 1 and K is 0. Moreover, at the same time, this Q output is 0 and the Q bar output is equal to 1. So the same 1 and 0 will also appear over here. And of course, since the clock signal is on, so this input of the NAND gate is also equal to 1. So now if you see, then all the three inputs of the NAND gate is equal to 0. That means the output of this first NAND gate will become 0. On the other end, for the second NAND gate, since any one of the input is 0, so its output will become 1. So now, if we see this third NAND gate, then here, this one of the input is equal to 0. And therefore, its output M will become 1. And the same 1 will also appear over here. That means for this fourth NAND gate, its both inputs are 1. And therefore, its output will become 0. That means whenever this J is equal to 1 and K is equal to 0, then during the on time of the clock, this M output will become 1, while the M bar output will become 0. And that is also the expected result, right? Because we know that for the JK flip-flop, when this J input is 1 and K is 0, then its output will become 1. So once again, let us see the same thing in the timing diagram. So as you can see, during this on time of the clock, this M output will become high. Now once the clock becomes low, then this master latch will get disabled and therefore it will maintain its present state. On the other end, during the on time of the clock, since the slave latch is disabled, so it will maintain its present state. And once again, during this off time of this clock, the slave latch will follow the master output. So let us see that. So now, when this clock signal becomes low, then the output of this inverter will become 1. And therefore, this slave latch will get enabled. Now at that time, if you see, then this M output is equal to 1, while this M bar output is equal to 0. So for this slave latch, this S input is equal to 1, while this R input is equal to 0. So for the SR latch, we know that when S is 1 and R is 0, then its Q output will become 1. And of course, here this Q bar output will remain 0. So as you can see, here this slave latch is following the master output. That means during this off time of the clock, this Q output will follow the master output. Now once the clock becomes high, then the slave latch will get disabled. And whenever it is disabled, then it will maintain its present state. So as you can see, this slave latch is following the master output. That means during the on time of the clock, based on the J and K input, this master latch is generating the output. And during the off time of the clock, when the slave latch gets enabled, then it is following the master output. So now, let us see the case when both J and K inputs are 1. And let us understand how this flip-flop will avoid the race around condition. So now in the next clock, if you see, then both inputs J and K are 1. That means for the JK flip-flop, its output should toggle. So now both J and K inputs are 1. So initially, here this Q output is equal to 1, while the Q bar output is equal to 0. So the same 0 and 1 will also appear over here. So during the on time of the clock, when this clock signal is high, then for the second NAND gate, if you see, then all the inputs are 1, and therefore its output will become 0. On the other end, for this first NAND gate, since any one of the input is 0, so its output will become 1. So now, for this third NAND gate, since any one of the input is 0, so its output will become 1. That means this M bar output will become 1, and the same 1 will also appear over here. That means for this fourth NAND gate, its both inputs are 1, and therefore its output will become 0. So as you can see, when both J and K inputs are 1, then the output of this master latch will toggle, and the slave latch will also follow the same outputs when the clock signal becomes low. So let us also see that. So once the clock becomes 0, then the master latch will get disabled. And at the same time, the output of this inverter will become 1. And therefore, this slave latch will get enabled. Now at that time, if you see, then this M input is 0, while this M bar input is equal to 1. That means for this slave latch, this S input is equal to 0, while the R input is equal to 1. And therefore, its Q output will become 0, while the Q bar output will become 1. So as you can see, the slave latch is also following the master output. So in the timing diagram, if we see, then during the on time of this clock, the output of this master will get toggled. And once the clock becomes low, then the master latch will hold its present state. On the other end, during the off time of this clock, the slave latch will follow the master output. And once the clock becomes high, then the slave latch will hold its current state. Now once again, during the on time of this clock, since both inputs J and K are 1, so once again, the output of this flip-flop will toggle. That means during the on time of the clock, the master output will become 1. And once the clock will become low, then the master latch will hold its present state. On the other end, during the off time of this clock, the slave latch will get enabled and it will follow the master output. So in this way, as you can see, the slave output is following the master output. The only thing is that here the slave output is delayed by the on time of this clock signal. And in this case, whenever both J and K inputs are 1, then there is a no race around condition. Because here, both master and slave latches are not active at the same time. And that is preventing this race around condition. So similarly, we can also design the master slave D flip-flop and the SR flip-flop. So in case of this master slave SR flip-flop, the two gated SR latches are used. So here, the output of this master latch is connected to the slave latch. And similar to the JKL flip-flop, here the inverted clock is applied to the slave latch. Likewise, using the two gated D latches, we can design the master slave D flip-flop. So in a simplified manner, this is how it can be represented. So this is the schematic of the master slave D flip-flop. And likewise, we can also design the master slave SR flip-flop. So in this master slave flip-flop, during the on time of this clock, the master is following the inputs. But the output of this master is appearing at the output only after the delay of this T on, where this T on is the on time of this clock signal. So as you can see, here the slave latch is following the master output. But it will be able to follow the master output completely only when the input is remaining constant during the on time of the clock signal. So suppose if the input signal is changing during the on time of this clock, then the slave latch will not be able to follow the change in the master output. So let us understand that by taking the example of the D flip-flop. So here as you can see, during the on time of the clock, initially this D input is equal to high. Therefore, the master output will also become high. And the slave is following that output when the clock signal is low. So here as you can see, during the off time of the clock, the input is changing. But during that time, since the master is disabled, so it will not follow any change in the input. And that is why, during the off time of the clock also, this master output will remain high. But now, during the on time of the clock, as you can see, this D input is changing. And due to that, this master will follow the same change in the input signal. So now, during the off time of the clock, the slave latch will become active. And now, it will follow the master output. So since the master output is high at this time, so the slave latch will follow the same output. So as you can see, in between, the master output got changed, but the slave was not able to follow that output change. That means if the input signal is changing during the on time of the clock, then the slave output will not be able to follow the master output. That means to use this master slave flip-flop correctly, we need to ensure that the input is not changing during the on time of the clock signal. And if we want to avoid that, then the input should get sampled only at the clock transitions. So the same thing is done in the another version of the master slave flip-flop. So this flip-flop is known as the master slave flip-flop with the data lockout outputs. So basically, by adding the pulse transition circuit with this data input, we can apply this data input only for the very narrow duration. And in this way, we can avoid this issue. So that's it for this video. And I hope in this video, you understood about the master slave flip-flop and you understood how this master slave flip-flop can avoid the race-around condition. So if you have any questions or suggestion, then do let me know here in the comment section below. And also subscribe to this channel to get more such videos.